This paper has two broad objectives. The first is to derive summary measures of association for the case when we may have one or more discrete outcomes. The second is to extend the concept of regression to the case where we might have a discrete outcome. At this point in the syllabus, you would have been introduced to the 2x2 table and to some measures of association such as the risk difference, the risk ratio, and the odds ratio. In this module, we will consider summary measures of association for ordinal data. Now, in general, we can continue to use measures such as the odds ratio or the risk ratio by ignoring the ordinal nature of the categories. However, in doing so, we lose some information, and we shall see that a better measure of association is given by something called the gamma measure. In subsequent modules, we shall also consider some further measures, such as Somers D, measures introduced by Kendall, measures based on alternative concepts, and so on. This is the introductory module on ordinal data analysis. I'm first going to review the concepts of ordinal data, introduce an ordinal data set, and then a measure called gamma, which is based on two new concepts, concordance and discordance. So firstly, nominal versus ordinal categories. We have previously started to look at 2x2 tables, which is two variables, both of which can be coded as binary variables. In this situation, it really does not matter if the categories can be ordered or not. But when we extend to a general K by L contingency tables, we have seen in prior examples, namely the one where we discussed the data sets which we would use for this paper, that categorical tables can be of many kinds. In some cases, the categories are nominal, in some cases ordinal, and in some cases, one could be nominal and the other could be ordinal. So to recapitulate, nominal variables are those for which the categories have no natural ordering. Examples are religion, nationality, and type of residence. Ordinal categories are those where the variables have a natural kind of ordering. Examples could be preference, education, smoking, and so on. Both nominal and ordinal variables arise in many applications, for example, in econometrics, biostatistics, the social sciences, and so on. We have previously noted that there is a measurement hierarchy when we define alternative types of variables. This measurement hierarchy ranks interval variables over ordinal variables over nominal variables. Now recall that interval variables are those for which the actual ordering of the category is possible, but the absolute number assigned to a particular category or to a particular measurement is also meaningful, as is the ratio of the two measurements. Ordinal variables are those for which it is possible to define an order. So, for example, we could say that A prefers a particular option more than B. However, the actual preference of A cannot be quantified, and the absolute measurement is not meaningful. A nominal variable is one where neither the magnitude nor ordering is possible. The measurement hierarchy says that it is valid to use methods for nominal data on ordinal data, but not vice versa. So this means, for example, we could continue to use our risk ratios and odds ratios for the case where we have one or more ordinal variable. Note that I have said that it is valid to use the methods. However, validity does not necessarily mean that it is recommended to use the methods, because there are some particular kinds of questions which arise naturally for ordinal data, and these can be addressed by developing special methods which take into account the ordering of the categories. So, for example, two additional questions which can arise for ordinal data. The first is, we might want to study average preference over categories, and we might also wish to study trends in preference. So whether, for example, the strength in preference increases monotonically over another ordinal variable, or whether there is any such pattern. So these are not questions which are natural for nominal data, and hence the need to develop additional methodology. So to reiterate, there is a distinction between nominal and ordinal variables with interval or ratio variables. Interval and ratio variables, the actual measurement is meaningful, and so is the ratio. For ordinal variables, the actual coding is not important, but there is an order to the categories. For nominal variables, there is neither magnitude nor ordering. Now note that even for the same underlying variable, we can choose to measure it either on an interval scale or on a nominal scale or on an ordinal scale. So for example, with education, we could measure it using an interval scale in terms of years of schooling. We could measure it on a nominal scale using a classification of private versus public, or we could measure it in an ordinal scale as primary, secondary, graduate, or postgraduate. The particular choice we use depends on the example and the particular research question which we wish to answer. So here is an example of a classification where both variables under consideration are ordinal. So along the rows, we have measured income in dollars, but rather than considering the actual income, we have classified it into four categories, which is income less than 15,000, income between 15,000 to 25,000, income between 25,000 to 40,000, and income above 40,000. So you can see that there is a natural ordering to the income categories. Job satisfaction is measured along the columns, and this has been categorized as very dissatisfied, a little dissatisfied, moderately satisfied, and very satisfied. So even though we are not able to actually measure satisfaction, we can order satisfaction in the sense that given two individuals, we could say that one is more or less satisfied than the other, although we cannot say how much. The source of this data is the 1996 General Social Survey of the National Opinion Research Center, and the data set has been studied. To define measures of association for ordinal data, we first have to define two fundamental concepts, that is, concordance and discordance. To do so, we first consider a pair of individuals, and we assume that their measurements are X and Y. So X and Y are the two random variables under consideration. For the example which we have just seen, X is income level and Y is job satisfaction. So we have two individuals, and measurements on the two variables, income level and job satisfaction, for each individual. The two individuals are said to be concordant if X1 is greater than X2 and Y1 is greater than Y2. Or if X1 is less than X2 and Y1 is less than Y2. So this means that if the income level of individual 1 is greater than the income level of individual 2, we would also expect that the job satisfaction for individual 1 is greater than the job satisfaction for individual 2, and vice versa. The individuals are said to be discordant if X1 is greater than X2, but Y1 is less than Y2. Or if X1 is less than X2, but Y1 is greater than Y2. So this means that of the pair, the individual who has higher income has lower job satisfaction. Concordance and discordance are two fundamental concepts, and most measures of association for ordinal data are based on the concepts of concordance and discordance. So, which are the concordant pairs for the example which we have already seen? Let us, for example, consider the three individuals whose income is less than 15,000 and whose job satisfaction category is little dissatisfied. Let us consider any two of these three individuals. So these individuals are tied on both income and job satisfaction, and thus they cannot be said to be concordant. Similarly, we can consider the one individual whose income is less than 15,000 and who is very dissatisfied, and another individual whose income is less than 15,000 and is one of the three whose job satisfaction is a little dissatisfied. Now, these two individuals are tied on income, so again, it is not meaningful to consider the concept of concordance. So this happens as we move along the same row or along the same column. What if we take one individual whose income is less than 15,000 and whose job satisfaction is very dissatisfied, and another individual whose income is between 15,000 to 25,000 and whose job satisfaction is little dissatisfied? So clearly, there is a monotonic behavior in both income and job satisfaction. That is, the individual with the greater income also has greater satisfaction. So this pair of individuals can be said to be concordant, and we can choose this pair in any of three ways. Similarly, we can see that from this table, 3 plus 10 plus 7 plus 6 plus 14 plus 12 plus 1 plus 9 plus 11. All these variables, all these individuals are concordant with the first individual in the 1-1-ed cell. Similarly, if we move to the adjacent cell, we can see that the number of concordant pairs is 10 plus 7 plus 14 plus 12 plus 9 plus 11. So proceeding in this way, we can see that the total number of concordant pairs for this table is 1331. To get the number of discordant pairs, we can similarly see that for the three individuals whose income is less than 15,000 and whose job satisfaction is a little dissatisfied, any of these individuals will be discordant with 2 plus 1 plus 0 individuals in the first column. And hence, these pairs can be used to get 3 into 2 plus 1 plus 0 discordances. So again, proceeding in this way, we can see that the total number of discordances for this table is 849. Now note that these are the sample measures of concordance and discordance. We can derive the corresponding population measures of the probability of concordance and the probability of discordance. So here, pi c, which is the probability of concordance, is twice summation over I and j, pi ij into summation k greater than I and k greater than j, pi hk. Similarly, the probability of discordance, pi d, is given by pi d equal to 2 summation over I and j, pi ij, into summation over k greater than I and k greater than less than j, pi hk. So most measures of association will be dependent on the difference pi c minus pi d, that is the probability of concordance minus the probability of discordance. The first and simplest measure is the gamma measure. The gamma measure is defined for the population as gamma equal to pi c minus pi d by pi c plus pi d. So the probability of concordance minus the probability of discordance divided by the sum of the two. This measure is due to Goodman and Kruskal in 1954. Its sample estimate is given by c minus d by c plus d, where c denotes the observed number of concordances in the data set and d denotes the observed number of discordances in the data set. Properties of the gamma measure. Well, firstly, it is symmetric in the sense that we can define gamma of xy as well as gamma of yx, and it does not really matter. The range of the gamma measure is minus 1 to plus 1, and it is interesting to study the cases when gamma is equal to 1, minus 1, and 0. The gamma measure is said to be monotonic, but not strictly so. So this means that if gamma is 1, then for a pair of observations xA, yA, and xB, yB, where xA is less than xB, it follows that yA is less than equal to yB, but not necessarily so. That yA is strictly less than yB. Similarly, for the case where gamma is equal to minus 1. Note that gamma takes the value 0 under independence, but that the converse does not necessarily hold. So, for example, you can refer to the book by Agresti to see a U-shaped bivariate distribution for which pi c is equal to pi d, and hence gamma is equal to 0. For the job satisfaction example, we have just calculated the number of concordances and the number of discordances as 1331 and 849. So we can calculate the sample gamma as 1331 minus 849 divided by 1331 plus 849, which is equal to 0.221. So we can conclude from here that we have some weak evidence that job satisfaction increases with income. It would be quite instructive for you to calculate the gamma measure for the four probability distributions given on this slide. So we are considering a bivariate distribution of xy with, say, x along the columns and y along the rows, and the cells give the corresponding cell probabilities. You should be able to show that gamma is equal to 1 for the first two examples, 0 for the second, and minus 1 for the third. For 2 by 2 tables, there is a simplification of the gamma measure. In fact, for the gamma measure, for the 2 by 2 case, is also referred to as Yule's Q, and it is related to the odds ratio. For the 2 by 2 case, it is possible to show that there is a simplification in the value of gamma. For the 2 by 2 table, gamma is also called Yule's Q measure. And it is possible to show that gamma is given by gamma equal to pi 11 pi 22 minus pi 12 pi 21 by pi 11 pi 22 plus pi 12 pi 21. Which can easily be shown to be equal to theta minus 1 by theta plus 1, where theta is the odds ratio. Thus, gamma is a monotonic function of theta that transforms from the 0 infinity scale to the minus 1, 1 scale. In subsequent modules, we shall consider some alternative measures of ordinal association. But very quickly, one alternative measure, which is called Sommers D. So Sommers in 1962 proposed a measure which is very similar to gamma with one difference, which is that as the denominator, we use pairs which are untied on X rather than those which are untied on both X and Y. So the sample version of Sommer's D is given by C minus D in the numerator, and in the denominator, the n choose 2 minus Tx, where Tx is the number of pairs which are tied on x. Now note that n choose 2 minus Tx is equal to C plus D plus Ty minus Txy, where the subscript denotes corresponding ties. And as this is greater than equal to C plus D, the denominator of D is at least as large as the denominator of gamma. Hence, we can say that mod D is less than equal to mod of gamma. Now, one property of D is that in order for D to be equal to 1, we need stricter monotonicity than for mod gamma to be equal to 1, in the sense that C or D must equal 0, and none of the pairs that are untied on X can be tied on Y. As for the case of gamma, there is a simplification for the 2 by 2 case, and in fact, for this case, D simplifies to the difference in the corresponding proportions. In this module, we have again reviewed the concept of ordinal data and contrasted it to nominal data and interval data. We have seen that while we can continue to use the measures developed for nominal data for ordinal data, we can improve by considering measures which take into account the ordinal nature of the categories. We have introduced the gamma measure, which is based on the concepts of concordance and discordance. We have also introduced a variant called Sommer's D. We have applied them to the sample data sets. In subsequent modules, we will introduce other measures, such as the measures due to Kendall, as well as consider more complicated situations where one might be ordinal, the other might be nominal, and so on. Later, we shall introduce the concept of polytomous regression, and this will allow us to extend the concept of regression to the case when the outcome is a categorical variable.